Hello and welcome to Cactus Abe's Garage. My name is Frederick and today I'm going to show you my new project car, which I thought why not share it with you if you're interested. This is my Volkswagen Caddy Mark 1, 1987. Unfortunately, this was supposed to be a part 1 for you guys, but it's actually part 2. Because I did a mistake. My camera was set to NTSC setting, not PAL, which I should have here in Sweden. So I filmed me. Let's see here. One sec. Yanking the engine and gearbox out and all of the wiring loom, dashboard, etc. Only to realize that my LED lighting in here flickered like a on camera. So I had to scrap it. But anyway, you guys are going to tag along with me now, moving forward. So let me show you. All right, so you have to excuse the mess around the car. I recently started to rent this garage. I've just shuffled all of my things here in a haste. This is currently what the car looks like. Dash removed. Seats weren't bolted in place when I bought it. By the way, this car is recently painted red by the previous owner, and I did what you should not do, which is I bought it in the dark. You should not do it. Besides, I was especially naive. I was thinking that if you paint a car, you have done everything right. That's not the case here. Let me show you. Let me just open the bonnet here. Where are you? One sec. Right, okay. As you can see, they painted in here as well. But can you see that? Hold on. As you can see here, I don't know if camera is picking that up, but there's a rust hole. There is some rust that has surfaced now. And there is rust all the way around. Here's another big rust hole. And that's not all. Beneath, I can't remember if it was in the front. No, not in the front. Here you can see, let me see if the camera picks that up, there, rust, and more rust. They didn't even take these off for painting it. But on the plus side, I got not one dash, not two dashes, but let's see here, is it? Three or four, I can't remember. Three dashes. Plus a whole lot of spare parts, as you can see here. At first, I was going to fit this. This is the Mark II dash. And look at these sweet, sweet dials. Yeah. But I'm not going to. What I am going to do is I'm going to fit this heating unit from the Mark II Caddy, which has AC, and then I'm going to modify the air vents and such, or well, not the air vents themselves, but the air ducts rather. and climate control unit to match up with the Mark II Golf Dash, so it looks as it should in there. Now first, before I fit the engine, I'm going to make up a CAD, you know, as Bad Obsession says, cardboard aided design, to see if that heating unit will even fit the firewall. I'm hoping it will, otherwise I have to do some welding, because I want AC. So yeah, now let's get some work done. Moment of truth now, if this is going to be an easy job or if I have my work cut out for me. So now that we are in here, I can definitely say without even testing this that it will never fit. It is too big. Here, as you can see here, it is going to take up the entire passenger footwell because the fan is going to be here. Okay, so since I've had a little bit of a setback regarding this and the HVAC system, instead of just going and sulking in a corner, anyway, I am going to tackle some other things instead, first of which being bleeding the brake system, because I think I forgot to tell you, I'm going to repaint it. I know it's already been painted red, but it's a crappy way of painting it because they have not masked off things like the foam here. And lots of stuff. There's a plate down here that's riveted in place. I suspect there's supposed to be some text on it, but they just went over it. And frankly, I have had enough of red cars. Most of my cars have been red. The reason that I'm going to repaint the car is because one, the previous owner or whoever did it did a very crappy job, did not remove the rust and replace it with new sheet metal, did not mask things or remove things properly. So anyway, I already had the paint, and the reason for that is my deceased Caddy Mark II was going to get that paint, but it was just too much rust. Way too much rust. So I lost interest, and I still have the paint, which is Audi Sepang Blue. So that's what's going to be splashed on this, the correct way, of course. But anyway, let's bleed the brakes, remove the brakes, let's get cracking. Thank you. bending the nipple. Not really that good. Come on. As you can see, I'm mushrooming it quite a bit, so don't do this unless you plan on removing it. Oh crap. So I guess this just have to drip on the floor. That hurt a lot. Holy crap. Ow. Damn it. One more night. I'll be
by your side. Okay.
All right then. So here we have everything in all its glory. Sorry about that. Let's start with the original setup. This caddy came with 240 millimeter discs and these tired old brake calipers. But I'm going to swap from 240 millimeter to a 280 millimeter brake disc. So this is from a Corrado G60, or I believe other models with the G60 have these discs as well. Here you can see this is a Brembo Max, but there you can see the, if you want to do what I'm about to do, there you have the serial number. And to pair with these G60 brakes, I'm going to go with this, which is from a Porsche, obviously. But it's a Porsche 986 Boxster. So this is the front calipers of the Boxster. If I remember correctly, I purchased these quite some time ago because I knew I wanted to do this. And there you can see 986 351 421 is what it says there. The left hand side ends with 422. So I'll put it up on the screen and in the description below. And the brake pads, you might think it's for the front of the Boxster, but it's actually the rear pads for it. I've gone with EBC red stuff, and as you can see here, they fit a treat in there. And also a good surface area. Very good, actually. So this is a bit of a mishmash. I'm not sponsored by anyone in this video, despite me mentioning EBC and Epitec, but I have to say, it's thanks to Epitec that I found this kit available. Otherwise, I would have just gone with a single piston caliper, and I mean, this looks so much more better. Especially with some sweet rims on there later on as well. So yeah, that's my setup. Now we are going to test fit it and see that Epitec really delivers and everything else. Well, honestly, Epitec did a really, really good job. Still, I'm not sponsored, as I said, but credit where credit is due. I had my doubts, you could say, based on previous adapters I've bought, but oh my god, look at how gorgeous this is. I can't wait till the car is finished. Oh, by the way, I have stainless steel braided lines as well for the front. Going to have it for the rear too. So, again, Corrado G60, 280mm brakes, brake discs. Porsche Boxster 986, front calipers, and rear brake pads. Sweet, sweet setup. Now, everything here is just finger tight because these are going to get refurbished and painted in... you guys know the orange, bronze kind of color that the Nissan GT-R has on its brakes. I'm going to try and find a color that matches that. And since this is going to be Audi Sepang Blue, I think it will match really, really, really well with the Nissan GT-R color here. To me, that would look perfect. That's what I'm going for. And as I said, going to refurb them with new rubbers and everything. And hopefully I can find someone to powder coat them. Otherwise, I would just have to do it the old fashioned way. So now we know this fits. And I'm super, super excited about that. This has been hanging over me because these are not cheap. Epitech says that most 15-inch rims will fit over this. So that's a huge, huge bonus. Because I don't want big 17-inch or 18-inch rims on this. That would just look silly. I want this to be kinda looking stockish. What I'm also thinking about doing is I don't really like these plastic extensions here. I like the width of it, but not that it's plastic because I live in Sweden and we have lots of salt on the roads. Plus, on the rear, if you remember earlier, those have rust underneath them. So I'm going to remove these and I'm going to try at least. I've never done any bodywork. And this isn't exactly the easiest line to do, but I'm going to try and replicate the width by extending the metal. That's what I'm going to do. But that's coming in the future before it's time to paint it, obviously. So now let's head to the rear and start disassembling it there. Someone, entirely not me, was a little bit of a dum-dum and talked to myself because I had not pressed record. So I kinda removed this whole section, which was actually a bit of a struggle because you see how much RTV or whatever you want to call this glue they have used. And here it wasn't even attached with the glue. It was just one thick line all the way down. But they have just gone bananas with it here. And you can see those wheel arch covers or wideners, whatever you want to call it, they were not on this car originally. Because here you can see two holes. So this car had the little covers here, as most Caddies do. Now at least I have pressed record. Yes, very good. And here is the majority of the rust on this wheel arch. It is a bit crusty all the way around, but for the most part it's looking good. But in order for me to replicate the plastic bit that was here, I'm going to have to cut it anyway in order to fabricate a new piece and extend it. So I don't care how much rust it is, as long as it isn't anywhere else, and it's actually looking pretty good. So far, I'm quite happy with this purchase. Despite buying it in the dark, it's a damn fine car for being, oh, let's see here, 33 some years old, something like that. Let's crack on. Bleeding the brakes. Let's see how much rust is hiding beneath this side. And these are also screwed in diagonally. So and different sizes. And only three screws, same on the left-hand side. Whoa, this is much looser. Thank you for that. Or, well, no, it isn't. Now it's kind of tight. I hope I don't smack the camera now. That did not work. Let's try this side. Come on, let go. Please, let go. Please. Whoops. As I said on the other side, when I forgot to turn the camera on, or rather, the record on, because the camera was on. I don't have a heat gun. Otherwise, that's a pro tip for you. That makes this a whole lot easier. Oh, it was a screw here. But that was not screwed into that one. It was just sitting there. This side is looking pretty much like the left-hand side. If you're looky looky here, hold on a sec. So this side is looking pretty much like the left-hand side. Rust here, not too much, but when you go here, quite a lot, as you can see here, quite a lot. But I'm not worried. I want to widen these anyway, so. Girls. Sadly, the camera died before reaching this part, but a fair bit of bashing had to be done to get the drum off. This, in case you ever need to service brake drums, this is an auto adjuster, which when you have the drum in place and you want to remove it, you line one of the holes up to this one, stick a screwdriver in there and push it upward, because it's cone shaped, as you can see there, cone shaped. So the more the pads wear out, the more this spring here will push it downward. Every time you brake, these push outward to the drum, and if they are worn down a bit, this one drops down. Oh, if any of you know what I can use as brakes in the rear, please let me know in the comments. I would really appreciate it. Otherwise, I will just have to scour the internet again. But if you guys know, why not help me out? So yeah, that's how this sits right now. Sorry state. In the next episode, I'm going to continue removing all of the brake lines and the steering column and yeah, the old gear linkage is out because the ALH engine that's going in here uses cable drive on the gears, that is. Yeah, I'm going to fill the next time with how I can match this up, and I'm also going to see if I can use the pedal box from the Mark II caddy, because that would make it easier. But I think the firewall is, it's the same story as with the HVAC system, that it's just too different. But you can always mod it, so I'm leaning to that side, because old cars do not have a collapsible steering column, so in the event of a really serious accident, you will push the column and the steering wheel up in your face or in your upper torso, and that's not good. So the steering column, which is over there somewhere, I think, from the Mark II, has a collapsible steering column, and I want to modify it into this so that I have a bit more security in the event of a crash. That's it for this episode. Thank you so much for watching. If you did like this, please consider giving it a thumbs up. I would really appreciate it. It would help my channel very much. And if you want to see more of this project, please consider subscribing. This is not the only project I'm going to bring up to my channel. I have another project, well, let's just say it's an old car, but a Japanese car, that's getting a V6 swap. So I've just started to gather parts for it so I can start with the conversion. So it's another conversion, but that's going to be my fun car. This is going to be a daily and a hauler, so to speak. Anyway, the other car, the Japanese car, is going to be my fun car. I'm going to try drifting with it, but I want it to have a more of a malleable setup, because I want to try lots of things. I want to try track days, I want to try time attack, I want to try drifting. So I'm going to create a build which is suited for everything, but not the best at anything. You know, jack of all trades. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you in the next episode.